pleased to welcome Diane back to Concordia. I teach in the intermediate area of studio arts in the graduate and undergraduate program where Diane studied, then known as open media. So born in 1974 in Saint-Joseph-de-Kamouraska, Diane Morin lives and works in Montreal. She studied in Rivière-du-Loup and then at Laval University, graduating from Concordia in Montreal with a master's degree in open media in 2003. She has been creating installations using kinetic art and new media since 1998, which this picture, she says, is from. She works with light, sound, drawings, and robotics to make in-situ installations in which kinetic, sound, and light events take place. She uses different procedures and apparatuses to make these events apparent and to preserve traces of them, photograms, video recordings, sound amplification, projected shadows. Her work has been seen in solo and group shows in Finland, Norway, Montreal, and elsewhere in Canada. In addition, she has carried out artistic residencies in Finland, in Gothenburg, Sweden, and in the Finnish Art Studio in Finland. In 2012, her work was exhibited in the 6th edition of Manifest Art, organized around the topic machine. At Circa in Montreal, in 2013, she developed the automatic projection apparatus, a kind of shadow theater in which she explored space, the object, and time. In June 2013, at the Clark Gallery, also in Montreal, she presented a kinetic installation based on a system of mechanical relays and binary calculation used in computer technology. This work received a special mention as part of VIDA 15.0 Art and Artificial Life International Awards. In 2010, Morin received the Canada Council's Victor Martin Lynch Staunton Award in Media Arts. Please join me in welcoming Diane Morin.
Thanks for coming tonight. I will present you a few projects since the maybe I can turn back these images. Since the beginning in 1998, I won't show them in chronological order. So it will be the main thing will be in chronological order, but there is few projects because the way I work, often I will work on project for a very long time, and one project will last many years, and sometimes I will reuse some part of the project into a new project. So because of that, the way I present will be a bit, sometimes we will go back in time and yeah. Also, I will present projects which have been exhibited, and I will also include some work in progress, because the process is always very important in the way I work. So I just included because I think it's interesting. It's an interesting way to get to know the work, is to know all the research behind. So I include a few things which are more in things in process which didn't yet became part of an exhibit, but that which may be became. So. Yeah, and feel free to ask questions if you have questions along the way. You can just interrupt me and ask questions. So I'll start with that project which I made. Maybe I can go back a bit. Yeah, I made that project like in 1998, and at that time I just finished the undergrad in visual art at Laval University in Quebec, and Well, that was not part of my undergrad, but just 1 year later, because as part of my undergrad, I start to use, I start to build some mechanism using various objects, mostly objects like everyday objects, often gender affiliate objects and close to the body objects. So I made that small installation where lots of motor or accessories for makeup like were just activated by some motor and all that was going on well, they were just moving really really fast, so that was the kind of work, well, partly of what I was doing when I finished the undergrad. And then I get that invitation by an artist center in Quebec City called Avatar, and their main mandate is to work with sound artists. And so they invite me to spend 1 month in their studio and to work with my mechanism. And I went there with the object I was already working with, but with the idea that I want those small mechanisms and those assemblages of small objects to interact together. But I didn't want to use computer or so I just had that idea that using only switches, like mechanical switches, I can connect them in a way that they will start to have some very basic interaction. So during the time there, I start to learn electronic. I was already like just on my own working with motor and a bit of electricity, but I didn't know anything about electronics. So I just start there to with a technician there, Steve Lebrasseur, who was working there at the time. He just start to show me some electronics. So I connected those mechanisms, so they will one of them will start moving and he will just push a button to make another of those mechanisms start moving also. And the new mechanism in movement will stop the previous one. So I was really interested in the idea of having something happening in time instead of, it was already moving what I was doing before, but then I really want to have that sequence of something happening at different time in space. So it's just like every mechanism has one light, and it will turn the light on, and it will start moving, and then another one in another part of the space will start to move also, and will turn off the previous one. So I don't have video documentation of that, but I think I spent some time to explain it because I think it had a huge impact on what came after that. So and also the way they were connected, I could not make it only with mechanical switches, but I used those relay, which is kind of a electromechanical switches, which and connect in a way that it will it's a circuit that when you you activate it, it will maintain its state for a while until you set it you reset it, and it's kind of the first way to do memory in computing. So I was really interested in that idea to that it's the basic of memory in computing. So I will come back to that later because it's something that come back more recently in the work, the use of that kind of circuit. But then I get that invitation by a curator named Pamela Landry she invited 5 women working with electronic at the time. It was in 1999. It's the year I start to do the MFA at Concordia, and I had that show first at La Centrale, which was on St. Catherine Street at the time. We used again the same very basic electronic circuitry to control the mechanism, but I didn't want to have the mechanism to show, I really I decided that because the mechanism themselves are something of grotesque, and well, which I think is very interesting. But at that time, I wanted to, I guess, I wanted to make it more about the time and about the idea of a microcosm and something, and about the a basic way to do mediation. So it's the mechanisms are inside those glass sphere. And they are moving inside, but you cannot see them. You can only see the shadow because there is a light also in the sphere. So the sphere will different sphere will light up at different moment, and there is a contact microphone inside of the sphere, so you you can hear the amplification of the sound happening inside with some speaker which are just tiny speaker which are outside. So you cannot really see the mechanism themselves, you only see the mediation through the shadow and the amplification of the sound. And then I this is something I made while in the MFA program, and I kept working with that those mechanism again, which I was building with small object. But then I wanted to kind of create the same thing that was happening inside those tiny glass sphere, but to have it happen in a bigger room, so we can also walk in that room. So I start to work on project where I was dividing a space with a translucent screen, and to have the mechanism on one side and to have a shadow projection on the other side. So the and then I had some mechanism which were able to move on wire under tension in the space. So while the mechanism was moving with the lights, then it will make like it will create different shadow on the other side. And it's somehow I was really interested in into somehow the fact that by having that those really simple circuitry to control the mechanism, there was no microcontroller or no computer controlling the entire thing. It's all independent mechanism, that one mechanism will move on the wire and will at the at one point it will activate something, it will activate another one. But it's like if it's the entire room which is filled with those wire, and there is no center point. It's like I was interested in the idea that the entire room became kind of a brain for the entire organism, or I don't know how to call it. So it became the so that's on the other side of the room. Well, that's not in the well, the first images were in my studio at Concordia, but this was an exhibition I made at La Chambre Blanche in Quebec City, and there I was again for a 5 weeks residency working on site for that duration, and I just split the room in two, and on one side there was an empty room with those shadow projection, and on the other in the other side of the room there was the wire that we just saw. And it's often the way I work. I really like to go somewhere to work for many weeks in residency and to produce the work on site. It's not always possible, but at the beginning of my practice that's most of the opportunity I got was like that, and it's the way I prefer to work. I think to work on site or not. So it became those kind of landscapes somehow, and there was four or five of them changing. Those will do some action, and then because a light somewhere else in the room will light up, then it will change completely, like from one tableau to another one. And I don't have a video of the previous one, but I will show some. Usually I don't show those videos, and I just rediscovered them recently, and they are not part of something I made as a final project, but some of the, because it's on 16mm film, and I made once one projection with 16mm film I made using my mechanism, but not this one. So this is more research kind, but I'd like to show it because somehow I keep talking about mechanism and we don't really see them really well. And those mechanisms, I made them mostly during my time at Concordia. And for many years I just keep building them with different objects I'll find around. And at that time I start to work mainly with white object because I was really interested into having instead of having them to look really like assemblage and bricolage, I want them to become more like organism somehow. And because I use objects of the same color to assemble them, then I think we have a different way of seeing them than when it's just completely together. So I was interested in those ideas while doing the MFA. And I won't show it all. It's just to give some visual of the mechanism I was working then. And at some point, so I was using them to do drawing that we will see later. And I never show the mechanism themselves, but mostly the shadow projection on the drawing I was doing with them. And at some point, so the next one. Yeah, and I made a few residency involving 16mm film, and I was interested into bringing those mechanisms into different contexts because I was using them for drawing, I was using them when I was going to have an exhibition using shadow projection. So there, that time I was invited into film residency in Mount Forest in Ontario, where that film teacher is inviting people in his countryside house to learn how to use 16mm film and to process the film on site. So that's why it's so strong quality of the film, because it's been processed by hand. Those mechanisms I was doing during the MFA, I was using them to do drawing, and the drawing was mainly what was being exhibited at the time. So those drawings were made using the same kind of mechanism we just saw, and I was creating them by sketching their shadow while they were moving on a large piece of paper on the wall. So I invented that setup where I have a table, a transparent table made of glass, and I use the mechanism on the table, and by having a light under the table, then I was projecting the shadow on the wall, and I was adding paper on the wall. So I was just tracing the outline of the shadow of the object many, many times while it was moving, and I was creating those kind of archive of the movement of the mechanism. And there, usually when I present them, also there is a layer of them. So there is, it's made on vellum paper, so it's slightly translucent. So you can see that you can see that behind the first sheet of paper there is another one, and you can slightly see that there is more drawing under. So it's about the layer paper and also the layer of the drawing of the outline of the shadow. And I guess I was interested in the idea of a drawing machine, but I was interested to have the body involved. So it's like, it's not like the mechanism was doing the drawing itself, but I had to act almost as a machine myself to be able to do the drawing, because I was just following its movements. I cannot just draw whatever I like, I had to. So it was almost a performative action, because it took hours to do, and sometimes it's really awkward position. So So at the same time I was doing those drawing, I also decided I want to. I kept working with those white mechanism and those white assemblage of objects, but I decided, okay, if I want, because I was really interested into how they behave, and but I have so many of them completely different, then I just decide, okay, I will redo the same many, many times, so then we will really see how they can behave in different way, more than if they are completely different. If they are completely different when they move on the ground, they will all have a different behavior, but if they are all the same and all the same attached together, then we will really see how the fact that they are attached together will make them behave differently. So I was more interested in that idea. Maybe it's easier to understand. In the small room at Circa Gallery here in the Belgo building in Montreal. It was in 2005. And when I decided to reproduce the same mechanism many times, I was in Banff doing a residency there, and I just decided to reproduce some of the object in porcelain instead of using the plastic. You see, those are the shower head in plastic that you can buy at dollar store, but I decided to reproduce those objects in porcelain, and to so I did that when I was in Banff, and then later on I decided to I really create the entire installation using them, because I already made that kind of mechanism, but using the plastic shower head. But then when I decided to reproduce the same, I decided to do it that way, and I was interested into the sound that he will make with the porcelain instead of the plastic. And the bang that we can hear in the video was the porcelain when it was hitting the ground. And because it was, the sound was really present in the video, but I think it was in the small room of Circa because it's a small, it's not a huge gallery, so the sound was the sound of the mortar, and the rhythm of the mortar was really present. And I made that exhibition as a work in progress. So I was going in the gallery every day at night when the gallery was closed, and I was using the mechanism to produce more drawing using the shadow of the mechanism, a bit like what we saw earlier on paper. I decided to do it directly on the gallery wall. And so here we can see a bit the, like, when I put them on those wires, well, those wires were under tension between two of the gallery walls. We can see a little bit of the shadow there that we were producing. And so during the month, there was more and more of those drawings, as we can see here. And when the gallery was open, the mechanism were always laying on the ground, as we can see here. So we never, the people who visit the exhibition, they never saw, like, they saw documentation of that. There was a small booklet to go with the exhibition where you can see that images, but they were never the mechanism were never on the wire when you go to visit the exhibition. But you can understand that by seeing the wire, and that by seeing the drawing, and by seeing the mechanism on the ground, you can see that there is a connection somewhere. But it's not all given, but it's obviously there is a connection between the drawing, and as you can see the movement also, you can feel the movement in the way the drawing are made. So I was really interested in that idea that it's, you can see that something happened, but it's not there happening now, but that something has happened. And I was really interested into the idea of having something so horizontal on the floor, a bit like in the previous work. That idea of something horizontal was there in the way the electronic was built, with no brain, but something that it just go like in different direction, but there is no brain controlling what's going on. So it's an idea that it's happening there, but in another way, just by laying everything on the ground. And that's just the way the electricity was coming into the room. It's just those gigantic Lego kind of blocks. So it's, I really find interesting to use those kind of objects that you don't recognize, or if you close it, you will recognize them. But it's, yeah. So they are just reverse. So that's more of the drawing on the wall. And that's another project which I also began while I was in the MFA program in 2000. I wanted to do something without using the electronic, but still I was interested in light. So I just started to do that video piece, and I didn't know nothing about video at that time, but I started to document in video small explosion happening inside object. So I was collecting again white objects, but then they needed to be hollow inside, so I can put some gunpowder and some powder for firework inside of the object, and I was documenting the explosion happening inside of the object. So I was interested in the idea that the explosion won't destroy the object, but it's kind of an explosion that f- fail somehow because it's not, it doesn't destroy it, but somehow it makes the object visible for a really short amount of time, just long enough we can recognize it, and sometimes it's not even long enough. And it's also a lot about waiting, because there is other, the waiting in between. And I usually show it in... as an installation. So I just collect those video clips for many years, and the first time I saw it, I think, was 2005 as part of a collective exhibition, and then in 2007. and in 2007 was the first time where I had an entire gallery on my own, so I can put the gallery completely in the dark. So when you enter the room, you can it's so dark when you enter the room that you have to follow the walls with your hand to just be able to manage the space. You have no idea how big is the space because it's completely dark. And once I it's always huge, quite huge projection. And once I had two projector, so it was interesting to have two of them, so you don't know on which one will the next object will appear. And to me, also, there was that... I was really interested also somehow, maybe... well, at the time, I was really interested also that in the idea that it kind of... I really connect the idea with the mechanism as an organism, and I was interested into them as being some kind of in the struggle for to maintain themselves. Like I was thinking of that when I was setting up the gunpowder inside, like to try to make it still longer. And I was interested. I think the most interesting of them were those where they, they kind of try to maintain themselves somehow. Well, I was interested in that idea back then, and then I read that text by historian of science in US who wrote that book about firework, and I was he had that idea that he was just talking about that moment in science where the science wasn't sure, like in the 18th century, where if the spark of life is coming from electricity or is it coming from chemical, and I was interested. I get back to be more interested in that aspect of them as mechanism, organism, and I decided to continue to work with them, but then to see if I can use the power coming from the explosion to make them move somehow. So I start that research, which is still ongoing, where I want to to connect many objects together with plastic pipe and see if they can help each other moving, or if they will, on the contrary, if they will restrain the movement. So I made many new experiments with in that way. Oh, but yeah. And this one, it's part of that research, but also I was interested in to see if... maybe I'll speak. More dramatic also because the I slow down the speed of the video, so so because I slow down the speed of the video, it's also slow down the sound, which is yet more low frequency. So that's why it became more dramatic somehow, and that's still ongoing because I never made a final piece where I did the editing like this, where the camera is changing. I was recording the same event but with different camera, so it's something on process to make a piece where you have those change, where you have the montage, because before that it was only the camera was always the one view. Yeah, but those are the one I made like when I wanted to have them moving, and most of them fail to move really. But they are visually interesting, so I kept collecting them. And again, when I showed that was an installation in the dark where they are projected in a large format. I made that one in 2008, I think. I think so. And now I'll go back in time. In 2006, I made that installation. It was the first time where I used again that idea of having the mechanism contained inside something. And to me, there is a connection between the idea that in the piece we just saw with the light contained in the object, but it's the fire and the light. So those ideas are mixing. But then I had both mechanism inside that big container moving and producing sound, and there was contact microphone inside of the container, and that sound was amplified. And there was two mechanisms. I put two wire under tension from one side of the gallery to the other, and there was two mechanisms going back and forth on those wires. And as I use again the very basic circuitry where it's just electromechanical switch that will control the mechanism. So one mechanism will reach one point on the wire and it will force the other one to go back. So they have that behavior which is somehow very predictable and very simple, but still it has some kind of hypnotic effect on the viewer, I think. And I was interested in the dysfunctional, always I think in all the mechanisms I've been making, there is that dysfunctional aspect to them, which I've been interested in too. And when the two mechanisms meet each other on the wire, then we'll change the shadow projection on the opposite wall. So it's never exactly the same projection because the light is going on and off at different times. So depending on the brightness of the light, the shadow will change. So that's another version of it's still articulation, the project I made in 2005 with the white mechanism, but I bring it to a larger space in Sweden where I had the ceiling was very high and the floor was so amazing. It was that really large, amazing floor. So I just expand the size of that horizontal layer of mechanism on the ground. And they were, I think I made them move even slower than in the first time, so then you can barely see them move, some of them you can barely see the movement, and they will change position like this on the floor, but over hours of time. And they work all the time. I never put sensor on them. I don't want, like, I want them to work all the time even when nobody is looking. I like the idea of them going on all the time. And even if they end up breaking sometimes, it doesn't matter to me. It's part of the piece that some of them may broke at some point, and it's still going on like that. And again, we are back in, well, the previous one was made in 2008, and now we are back in 2000, I think, when I start to do those kind of drawing, but on photographic paper. So I was using the small mechanism I was creating at the time, and I was using them to produce those photograms. So photogram is a technique where you put an object in a photographic paper in a dark room, you turn on the lights, and then you will have a print of the object on the photosensitive paper. So I was using my mechanism to make those images where I start with having only one mechanism at a time on a piece of paper, and I will make it move and have a print of the movement of the mechanism on the paper. And I was interested in building very, very simple mechanism, like the minimum it takes so the mechanism will move on the surface of paper. So some just with something moving like this, with like something will make some friction and we'll push it towards, and some other parts are more slippery, so we'll move in different ways. So I was just experimenting with many of them. And sometimes many of them were on the paper at the same time, and sometimes some will stop moving or not move at all. So it was all an experiment each time to see. So we can see the trace of the movement. And again, it's a project I made over many years. So the previous one were made in 2000 and 2001, and I started again to make them in 2006. In the previous one, I was turning on a light in the room, which will impress the entire sheet of paper, except the place where the object was moving. But then I start that other process, which again I want to involve the body in the process of making the images somehow. So I was having a light in my hand, and I was trying to follow the movement of the mechanism while it was moving on the paper. So that's why it's only one part of the images which is black. It's the part which is exposed to the light. And we have the trace of the object that moved maybe over a few minutes at a time while I was trying to make have some fluidity in the movement so I can follow it. So there is a performative aspect to the process of in the process of creating the images. So again, it's a mechanism that made, and the images are like that big, and maybe it took 5 minutes to the object to make a big circle while I was following the object with the light. Next I will show one of the objects that I've been using to do some of the photogram that we just saw, and that I also later on used to make a new series of drawing which end up in the artist book. So that was the cover of the artist book. So that object, it's only a small, it's a key from a typewriter machine, so we can see the this part is the place where you push with the finger, and the other part is, well, it's all the part inside of the typewriter machine. It's all those black piece of metal that will connect the place where you push with your finger and the other place where it's the paper. So I just took it apart and reassembled it in a different way with a mortar. So it's just basically crawling on the surface of the paper, and it's able to move a bit. So I use it to make a photogram, but I also use it to make that artist book where I again use that setup with a light table where I put that object that we just saw on a piece of glass with a light under, and it was projecting the shadow of the mechanism on the wall, and I was tracing the outline of the shadow with different color, and I actually include in the artist book the code that was used to make the mechanism move. So that time it was programmed with the computer to move at a certain speed in one direction and then to change direction, and I include in the code the color of also of the of the pencil I was using to draw. So when in the code the color was changing in the code, like, because in a programming code you need to name sometimes name some section or to name, okay, you create a loop and that loop will you need some variable that will make the loop happen that amount of time, and that variable you can decide to name it the way you want. So I just use the name of the pencil I was using. So when the time when the color was changing in the court, I was changing pencil, and so you can if you look closely, you can recognize which part of the court correspond to which part of the drawing because of the color in the code and the color in the drawing. So you can see that the outline, when the mechanism was in one position, it's let's say you have the brown there three times, it means that the loop was happening three times in the code, and then it was changing colors, I was changing too. So again, I was interested in the idea of the drawing machine, but with me being involved as a performative aspect. So again, that's not a project that at which I've been exhibited, but I just to show how the things I use in one work can just move into another one, I just decide to include this. So it's well, it's not exactly the same mechanism, I think, but it's in the same series, and maybe I think that the same one will appear in the video after that, because I decided to I really wanted to make an installation using those mechanisms that I was using for drawing as part of an installation, which may happen one day, but I was interested into having them moving on those wires, which are it's musical instrument string, and I was amplifying the sound of them moving on those wires. So it's mostly test, it's not, it never happened as a part of an installation. I thought it was interesting to see the same mechanism in different contexts. Where I decided it was part of that residency and that one long year research project called Méandre at Diamond at Gatineau, where a few artists were invited by Nicole Zingras as a curator to do research on drawing and technology. So I decided to make that installation using the same a setup similar to the one I was using to create the drawing that we saw earlier, but to use the setup so the drawing will happen somehow in the gallery space, and that the process of making the images will be there for the visitor to see. So I had those old drawer from furniture, which I find in the street, and I turned them into light box, and I had different objects inside of them, like a part of a typewriter machine, part of a knitting machine, a calculating machine, and with light under the drawer, which were turning on and off at different times with a sequence, it was creating shadow projection on the top part of the drawer, because the bottom part was there was a transparent plexiglass on the bottom of the drawer, so I can see the objects in them, and then on the top part I put a translucent plexiglass, so then the projection can happen. So I'll show a video. And it's very difficult to document because again it's happening in the dark completely, and it's a room where at first you don't see where you are because it's so dark, but then because there is some light in the room, after a few moments you kind of situate yourself in the space and you can see more of the space. And I was interested in how it can create animation, even if the object is not moving with a certain condition. And because now it's not moving, it's really the light under which is projecting. So you kind of have somehow an illusion of movement, but it's not real. It's an animation, a bit like animation movie. Time and how different sequence in time with different laps and different interruption in the rhythm of the brightness of the light will make a completely different animation. And the sound is contact microphone inside some of the drawer. There is real movement, like this one is moving for real, and the sound that we hear is the sound coming from them. So it's only the scratching of the mechanism on the surface and the sound of the motor, because the motor is moving with a pulsation. So we can hear that in the sound, but it's only amplification and it's no. Yeah, it's direct amplification from the contact microphone. Some of those drawings, I won't talk a lot about them. I made that artist book in 2007 where I just decided to use the other drawing I was making to understand the electronic circuit I was making, because I really teach myself how to do all those electronic circuits. So I made lots of drawing, and somehow sometimes the drawing I was just so wrong, but then it's by drawing again that I realize, oh, that's so wrong, it cannot work. But I really find them interesting by themselves. Like this one was when I was trying to understand how to make a complex LED system, which I use for that installation, which is more recent. This one was in last year, in 2013, at Circa in the Arts Gallery. And I reused the same animation effect which was happening in the previous project with the shadow, where if you put some object at a certain distance from the light and from the screen where it's projected, then the shadow will kind of phase together and will overlap. And just by doing that, I was fascinated by the fact that it's the distance between things that creates the animation, and it's not like in film where it's the film which is moving, but now it's really the distance between the object that will create the animation, and the animation can be different depending on the distance. So I was really interested into turning the distance into that time animation. So I used those three, which are from architect models. Thank you. And then in 2011, I think I started to work on that other project, Le Grand Calculateur, where I really wanted to go back, because now, like the previous project and the one before, I was using microcontroller to control the electronic. I was not doing everything like with mechanical thing, which allowed me to make those more complex animation. But then I really missed the time I was working with very more simple electronic where I can control everything. So I went back to this idea in the first project we saw, where I connect electromechanical relay together, and it was the first in the history of computing, it was one of the first way the first computer were made. It was with using electromechanical relay. So I really wanted to bring that back into the work and maybe push it further. And I decided to work on a new installation, and those are drawings to go with that. I saw that series of drawing where I was thinking of how that can happen in space, because I didn't want to just to reproduce a kind of simple computer, because you can do that to just connect a relay and be in a small box like this, and already you have something that can make addition and can store something in memory. But I didn't want to do that small object. I want to as something where the visitor can experiment the space as well as the computing system. So I just started that series of drawing when I was thinking about the space and how that can happen in space. And also how I will connect those things together. So this, I go back again to that. It's a simulator. I just show at the beginning a slide like this. It's again, it's just a way, it's just a still from a software I'm using to simulate circuit. And you can use it to draw. It's also a great learning website. It's by some researcher in Hamburg in Germany, and they have those circuits that you can look and understand how a computer is working. So it's the tools I'm using to teach myself how to make those circuitry. So this is the basic of a computing system where you can make addition. So I just it's just a combination of logic gates and electromechanical relay. So I stopped using that to create that installation, that which will compute. It's just a simple computing system. It will add. It will be able to count. Well, it's still in progress, and I showed it at Clark Gallery last spring, and I kept working on it during all the duration of the exhibition. So at one side of the wall, there was those glass tube using clinical laboratories to, and I just transformed them into simple switches. So there is water inside, and when there is a motor which activate them, and they will just have that simple movement. And when the water is touching them, it will just create a contact. And so it's just a simple way to create data, which will be computed then by the computing system. So that's the computing part. In one side of the gallery, you have that kind of a corner which I built for on site. So you have all those relay which I made using old technique of assembling circuitry. It's just calculation so on the background you can see the small water switch. And then there is wire that cross the entire gallery to go and which cross the wall there, and that system will just calculate how many switches are on at the same time. So that's basically the same circuitry that we saw as a schematic in the previous slide. And I made those small display, which it's also based on old. I find those old display from before the LCD display exists, where you can display number, but with a complex structure with optic inside, and with light, so the number will be projected only in one screen. So it can, at some time, very short in the history of display, there was those display like a bit like those mechanical ones that maybe we know more because they were used in train station, where it's a flap of mechanical number. Well, it's a similar kind of thing, but using light and optic. But mine are much simpler. They don't use optic, but it's just again that idea that if you have shadow phasing and overlapping, you can have the same shadow happen at the same place on a surface. But now it's not a shadow, but it's a light because there is a layer of. Yeah, there is gabarit, I don't know how to call it in English, like that the numbers are cut into a piece of vinyl, so a stencil, yeah. So, yeah, and then the overlap, so can be, like, when the data will change, then the zero will turn into one, and it's just light projected on the surface. So it's simple. So I will show the video. And the sound that we hear is the sound of the electromechanical relay are switching on and off, and they do the calculation, then they make that clap because it's a mechanical, and it's made of metal, so it just produces that sound of clapping. Calculating in binary number, so all the displays are 0 and 1 because the computing is happening in binary number. But eventually I'm still working on that, and an extension of that installation will be another display which will turn the binary number into decimal number, and then it can involve more relay but also mechanical part that will display number in decimal. So it's really something that can expand in space. I think it's still in progress, and I will keep working on that. And then again, that those schematic. This we saw before. It's the same flip flop that we saw at the beginning. So it's that circuit that when you put it in a state, it will remain in that state until you reset it. So it go back to its previous state. So and that's the memory. That's the basic way of to do memory in computing. So I was interested into made an extension of the previous project, Le Grand Calculateur 1, which is called Le Grand Calculateur 2, which will be able to act as a flip-flop and to store the data somehow, but using mechanical flip-flops. So I don't even use electromechanical relay like in the previous one. It's only switches and motor. So the motor will move just hit some switches, and it will stop at some point when it hit the switch, and until it gets another data, it will stay there until you reset it, so it go back to the other state. So so it's that's the first step in that direction, and eventually I want to connect both installations together. But for this one, maybe I can talk about how it looked like, because I really wanted to be more material. So I went back to create a porcelain object, like I was doing in the beginning with the shower head. And I used those those round shapes are it's cast from piece of wood which are used by people who make art, like felting with felt. So it's just a piece of wood which has a round shape or different shape for people who make art, so they can create the shape. And I had those objects for many, many years, and I was interested in how they somehow relate to the body, but not really, because they are so geometric shape. So I just decided to use that those basic as object to create the object there. So it's just those a mix of plastic pipe and different metal pipe. And those pipes are used for lightning also, so you can have the wire going inside and you don't see them. So I didn't want to have just those chunk of wire all over the place. So by using those pipes, it's really great because I can have an articulation, like the pipe will be able to move and have that articulation, and the wire will be contained like this. This part is moving, but the wire go inside, and it's just organized in a way that it can move with the wire inside. So it just make a piece really, really neat and really geometric instead of being that organic piece of wire. So I was interested in that, those articulation. So it's just that the basically now it's really acting like a flip-flop, so it can just set itself into one position and come back. So that's really what's happening in it. But I'm interested into having many of them, and yeah. So I think that's it.
So we'll open it out to questions now. Yes, I don't know if you want to call on people or have them just holler out, or what. There's got to be a lot. I just had my mind blown, so let's see what you guys say.
So seeing your overall work, seeing that you go back to basic mechanisms and basic movements, does that still treat you more than like the programming controls, or is that something you're also equally invested in?
I guess it depends on which. I guess it depends because when I work more with the programming, like with the piece with the trees, but well, of course I can. It can be fast, so I can really work with different speed and different distance, and I can just put my focus on something else to create the animation. While when I'm doing this, it's really I really like that because there is no extra stuff. There is no computer involved. It's really, but it's more simplistic what's happening. It's really simple, and I really like that you can. I guess also that I can control art. It's really, and if you invest a bit of time, you can really see what's going on. You can visually understand that electronic circuit. So I think it's interesting for me and also for the people. And there is no hidden part like a computer somewhere. Well, I don't use computer in the installation, but still, a microcontroller is like a tiny computer. So, yeah. So in that installation, there is no computer hidden somewhere doing some unknown mysterious stuff. So I really like that. Yeah.
Your work is really aesthetically beautiful. And but it's also like the most difficult way to create a drawing, or the most difficult way to take a picture. And I just wanted to know your side into why your decision of doing that, because the trace seemed to be a very important part of the whole work.
Yeah.
But the trace is something that you could have achieved in more simpler ways, I guess. So
yeah.
I want to know if you can expand into that.
Well, I don't know. To me, the drawing are just part of the larger system where there is the mechanism and there is the drawing which can happen.
So you create the mechanism and then kind of you're kind of open to what it can bring.
Yeah. And sometimes sometimes the same mechanism will just be part of an installation, and sometimes it will just be used as its capacity to produce an image. But it's different state of the same thing. I think that's something I'm interested in too, is to have something in different state, and it's still, you can see the mechanism moving, or you can see its trace, it's just different time.
You mentioned earlier that you involve basically body movement, working with machines, for example, when you were imprinting. And I'm wondering if that's still something that interests you, that sort of dance basically between you, the machine, and the light.
Yeah, I kind of miss that, and sometimes I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking about the last time I did that, the wall drawing, for instance, in the gallery was 2005. So it's a long time ago now. So I'm thinking maybe I should revisit that eventually. I think it's something, yeah. But it's a long time. Well, the photogram was 2008. So eventually, I think he might come back. But yeah, because lots of those things are cyclic and they come back.
I don't usually do this. I actually have a question, but I'm not exactly sure how to frame it. It's just something about like the relationship between the these things are both so creaturey and so sort of computery at the same time. And I find it's like it kind of blows my mind the way that logic meshes, because I don't think about those things as meshing.
I think very early in the practice I was interested into how those things can start to look as organism, and how we can start so easily to anthropomorphize them and to feel empathy and to really feel for them. And I was interested in that, how that happened, that we start to have the feeling for that thing. And it's really easy that I think already it's moving and already we feel empathy somehow. Mm-hmm. But I guess it's an idea which I've been there very much. And yeah. I don't know if it's
But it's also interesting in your practice, you're also combining sort of traditional methods with new media, about drawing, and you're mixing it with machinery, and I feel like you're kind of playing with that, those dualities in some way. It's not really a question either, I'm just trying
to believe. Yeah, well, I think it's interesting to bring back old technique and to see if we will see them differently, if we mix them together or put them aside, and it's just a way, the same way I just bring objects together, like from different system, and I put them together. I guess it's the same, different technique from different period of time. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a collage.
It's very interesting.
I found it really interesting, the piece of Circa, where you just had the drawing and you refused the movement, but you implied it. With everything on the spot.
Yeah.
So I find that play of what we do see and how you work with that very interesting. Is it something that you move through as you research and then decide, or how did you decide not to show those objects?
Yeah. Well, actually, they were moving on the ground. What we didn't saw was them moving on the wire,
which was
the setup I used to make the drawing.
The drawing.
So there was that missing part, which I do find more interesting not to have, because then it gives more, it gives less information to the viewer, but then I think he gets a more rich experience, because he can, So I think, I really like that project, and maybe I like it more than the when I installed again, like in Sweden. There was no wall, so I cannot draw on the wall, or I cannot stay in Sweden for a month. So,
yeah.
So I didn't do the drawing for that,
yeah.
And somehow I was missing them. I think it's interesting to have them in connection with the drawing on the wall. So I think it's
anybody else? Okay, well, then we can carry this conversation on at the bar. So, let's get the end of your time.